Hi there folks, I'm Zerfall, and welcome to another new Let's Play adventure. Today we're going to be playing a Plundered Hearts, an Infocom interactive fiction. This is the 2016 Valentine's Day special, and it's going to show because this is one of the few, I believe there was only two Infocom games that were marketed towards women, and this one's really going to show its age, 1987, because it's very much like a Harlequin romance novel, I believe. I've only played a little bit of it, just to do a little bit of testing, and that seems to be the case. This feelie that I'm about to read is going to give us most of the backstory. It's a letter from Jean Lafond, the governor of Saint-Sinistra. And the main antagonist of the story.
Honored lady, it pleases me that you have the wit and gumption not to feel obligated to wait for your father's permission to reply to my letters. Of course, he could not refuse you the opportunity of writing to myself, his new friend and governor. Well, I customarily describe the beauty of my little kingdom. This time I have less than good news to impart. Your father has been taken ill of a wasting tropical disease. My own surgeon has reviewed his condition and predicts that without loving encouragement, he may not survive more than a few months. Dimsford, too ill to write himself, begged me to inform you, his only daughter, of his situation. With due respect, I suggest that you take ship to Saint Sinistras by the first opportunity. I am convinced that the sight of your beautiful face will dissuade your father from his melancholia. I have instructed Captain Bartholomew David of my flagship La Fondue to deliver you to my graceful charge. He should arrive in London directly after you receive this missive. Pray accept this banknote to defray the cost of a new wardrobe. Any guest of mine must be suitably dressed. Trusting your voyage will be comfortable, I am your most sovereign lord, governor of Saint Sinistra, Jean Lafond.
So, let's get this game started. Perhaps if I'm in the correct window here, there we go.
Late one spring night in the West Indies. A crash overhead. Pirates are boarding the La Fondue. The first mate hurries you into Captain David's cabin.
Good, you brought the girl, David smirks. She'll keep the pirates busy. She was only a tool of Lafond's anyways.
Let me just find that cough. A man on the deck screams in agony, and Davis starts.
Let's go! The captain thrusts you on the bed and walks out, locking the door. His laughs echo. Best get comfortable, girl. You're likely going to be there for the rest of your life.
Cabin on the bed.
You are in the officer's cabin, lit by the firelight glowing through a porthole. A door is to the starboard. Except for the built-in bed, the room seems to have been emptied thoroughly. If Hurley. Alright, so we're stuck here, and there's no way for us to get out, as far as I'm aware. Let's look around. Yes, that's all we've got. Let's stand up. Whoops. Oh, there's no way to. I don't know the shortcut to say the last thing and then fix it. You get out of bed. Alright, let's check out what we've got here. Does that just work? Okay, you have your reticulum hanging from your wrist. It seems that your reticulum contains some smelling salts and a banknote. You are wearing your kid slippers, a linen chemise, and a cotton frock. So let's examine our smelling salts. You always carry your smelling salts for emergencies. There is a small tag on one of them. Let's read tag. It says, for cases of vapors, hysteria, or collapse, revive the person with the smelling salts. Suddenly the slip lurches to one side, throwing you off balance. A coffer slides from underfoot and bumps against your foot. Let's give that a look. Well, let's actually examine the banknote we have first. This is the banknote that came in your game package. Amazing. All right, let's
Examine the coffer. It's a small, heavy chest. Locked with a key. It's closed. Let's examine the door. It's closed. You recognize a voice from far away.
Don't take that. Look, the cabin.
Look in the cabin at the stern. You'll find some fun there. It sounds like Davis. What a dick. He's clearly using us to try to distract the pirates as he escapes. Don't know how well that's going to work out for him. Can we open the door? It appears to be locked. I guess not.
Crash! You whirl around to see the door shatter, kicked in by a hulking man, his twisted visage blackened with soot and blood. My name is Andy Crowley. The ladies learn to love me.
Sniggers the pirate, advancing towards you. Alright, let's kick Andy in the nuts. Ah. Kick Andy.
Your slippered toes could not hurt Curly. Avast me, but ye be a beauty, sniggers the pirate.
Why, they really like the word sniggers, don't they?
His breath is heavy with rum. Captain Jameson's, we got him, cried a rough voice.
Prithee pardon? Okay, so what else could we do? Could we... see, can we save? Oh, shoot. I don't know if this is going to work. I might have messed this up already. Couldn't create a save icon. Couldn't create icon file. Okay, well, I guess we're just going to have to hope that this works. We're going to scream. See that... Give us points, maybe?
Help me, you cry, hoping someone will help you. They calls me Andy, but I'm really Randy, sniggers the pirate advancing towards you.
Wow.
Crilly drags you despite your resistance towards him. Then suddenly he grunts, stiffens, and slumps into your arms. Stunned, Crilly collapses at your feet, his eyes rolling. A tall form blocks the shattered door. One fist still raised from striking your attacker, you catch a glimpse of the hard masculinity of his broad shoulders, the implied power of the scar that etches the stranger's jaw, and feel tremors course through your veins. Then you realize how ragged are his shirt, patched breeches and high boots. Intuitively, you understand. He is the dreaded Falcon, scourge of the sea. Alas, your fate is sealed. Resigned, you meet his blue eyes. Sea blue eyes.
The Falcon conquers, yells someone.
All right, let's give him a look over. Whoops.
Jameson carries the aura of a powerful, unusual. Wait, Jameson carries the aura of a power, not a power.
Jameson carries the aura of power unusual in men so slim and tall. The strength of a willow in his hard, sea-worn body, straight shoulders, and resilient. Chestnut hair tousled by the wind, framed by the tanned oval of his face.
A jagged scar etches one cheek, harsh against the warmth of his lipid blue eyes.
To your surprise, the stranger bows.
Well met, my lady. His accent is cultured and his smile vibrant.
I am Captain Nicholas Jameson, known in these waters as the Falcon. Your father has sent me. He chuckles at your glare of distrust.
Yes, you are like your sire. You needn't believe me untried. I carry this.
And he hands you a missive. All right. Let's go ahead and read the missive.
The missive is in dear Papa's handwriting.
Dearest child, you are in gravest danger. La Fonde is a viper with the smile of a saint, my most particular enemy. I have only now learned the depth of his deception. Should La Fonde get you in his power? It is unspeakable. I have sided with Nicholas Jameson, a sea captain and a gentleman whose circumstances have driven him to extreme measures, even branding him a pirate. Nevertheless, I trust him, and so may you.
You will be safe, but there is another for whom I fear. My horse is waiting, and I ride to her rescue. Jameson will deliver this to you. Should anything happen to me, you must rely on him. I remain with love, your father.
The pirate captain glances around the empty room, then notices the coffer. Davis's safety box. My men were hoping I'd find it. He takes it and nudges the unconscious man on the floor. I wonder how Crewley knew you were here. Just his bad luck. He'll be flogged when he wakes. The pirate bows. My lady, I offer you my protection and my ship until your father is free. Oh, may I? With a creak and a crash, somewhere a mast falls to the deck. I guess we'll tell him yes. So Falcon, to Sam talking to him, yes. You nod tentatively. He chuckles. Brave lady to trust a stranger and a pirate. Who knows? Perhaps I forged your father's signature. Keep by my side as we go to my ship. Few sailors respect a lady's dignity. He helps you through the door. Deck. The deck is an avalanche of noise and blood, lit by roaring fire, silhouetted forms crash swords dancing around screaming wounded. Out of the smoke stakers Davis, tugging a bloodied knife from the back of a pirate. Davis's eyes gleam white from a face blackened and bloody. His lips are dark red, as if he has been drinking blood. He turns to face you. Let's examine Davis. Davis is ugly with fear. Davis leaps across the deck to your side. I can't remember how I made him sound already. Free me or she dies, he yells, jabbing a knife up to your throat. In one smooth motion, Jameson draws his rapier, pulls you free, and stabs. Davis slumps into a bloody heap. Swooning, you fall into the Falcon's arms. You are dimly aware of being carried to the other ship, down a short flight of stairs and laid gently on a soft bed. When you gather your strength to look around, the Falcon has left you in peace. You remain confined to this room, a large cupboard blocking the door. Meals are brought by a peg-legged old man and eaten in silence. Of your handsome rescuer, you see nothing. Slowly, the days pass. 2 days later, we're now in the captain's quarters. You leer awake from a bored nap. Focusing on something shiny, you discern it to be a new ring on a strong hand in the act of tying a ribbon onto a rapier. The man with the rapier and the ring turns. Sorry, I tried not to wake you. You sit up as if the bed has caught fire. For this is the Falcon, changed from his rags to a finery of all red velvet and white lace, and in your presence. Captain's quarters on the bed. You are in the captain's quarters of the Helena Lewis, where you have been trapped for these past days since your rescue from the La Fondue. The room has a masculine air with ebony paneling, a large messy table, and a rumpled bed upon which you lie. A curtain masks the forward exit, and the gilded wood decorates the sill of a tall window looking aft. All right, so we're finally getting into things here. Let's check out this ring that the Falcon has on. I don't know why I keep X mining. Made of copper, the new ring has a curious design of gargoyles, curled tongues extended on its flat face, with Sal Sapit Omnia, or probably Omnia, engraved on the bottom. Alright, let's check Falcon out again now that he's all dressed up. Jameson is finely dressed in a red velvet coat and full breeches, with a long gold embroidered vest and waterfalls of white lace at his neck, wrists, and boot tops. His rapier is bedecked with a fringed gold ribbon. He wears no wig, his unpowdered hair tied neatly at the back of his neck. We have anchored off Saint Sinistra, says Captain Jameson. I must look like a guest of Lafon's dance tonight. I will find and free your father, and then, finally, wreak my revenge on Lafon. He half draws the rapier from its scabbard. Ooh, I wonder why he wants revenge so badly. Well, now, if we wait, he should just keep talking. Time passes. I'm sorry you have to be confined down here, but I don't trust my lonely crew with such beauty. Cruelly isn't the only man aboard with few principles. He smiles at you, eyes lingering, and takes your hand. You feel your color rising. If anything goes wrong, turn to Cookie. He's quite deaf, but capable. He'll see you through. Time passes. His look darkens. You should know why I hate La Fonde. Some years ago, as my brother and his bride sailed to a new life in Virginia, pirates struck. Their ship was boarded, looted, and burned. The women taken, never to be seen again. A sailor, the one survivor, watched as a man of La Fonde's description shot my brother in the back as he tried to save the woman. La Fonde has now bought respectability, but he shall never buy peace. Jameson straightens resolutely, bows, and departs. Okay, so that's the end of that. Let's stand up and look around. We're in the captain's quarters. We kind of already knew this stuff. All right, let's look out window. The moon beckons across the lagoon to St. Sinistra. Moored to the stern is a skiff. Interesting. All right. Let's open curtain. You pull the cloth aside momentarily. Behind it, a large cupboard mostly blocks the doorway. Let's open cupboard. The door is on the other side of the large cupboard. Can we examine it? You can only see the back of the large cupboard. You might be able to squeeze past it. All right, let's examine the table. I hate when they have those things like, that doesn't do it. You have no need for that, milady. Oh, I guess they both didn't work. You hear the large cupboard scrape. You turn to see Captain Jameson. Hello, I came to give you this, my allotment from the coffer. He nods to the box in his arms. Jameson starts to pin a jeweled brooch on your clothes, but... Devil take it, the clasp is broken. I'll have it repaired. He folds the pretty thing into your hand. And I meant to reassure you that my men suddenly abandoned ship. They are off to help me. Oh, if they do. Rodney will stay behind with you. He drops the coffer on the floor, smiling in farewell, and walks swiftly away. All right, so. Let's, examine the bed. Someone appears to have tumbled out of it in a hurry. Quite. Let's, go ahead and examine the brooch. All diamonds winking fire. Tears of sapphired and crushed rubies in an oval setting. It's a pity that the clasp of the jeweled brooch is broken. The gold pin at the back swings about uselessly. Let's open the coffer. Is there anything left in it? Ah, an invitation. Let's, well, we should take it first. Taken. Let's read. Whoops. Aha. The invitation addressed to Davis in honor of Jean Lafond's recently proclaimed governor of Saint Sinistra. A dance at his mansion, Ananas Road, Saint Sinistra. Formal dress. And invitation required. A ball. You haven't been to a ball in months. Men clomp around overhead, and a rope ladder unfurls itself past the window. Jameson climbs down it, entering the skiff that awaits him below. He rows to the island as the men above your head disperse, calling farewells to their captain. All right. Well, let's try leaving. I believe the exit is to the north. The large cupboard is not flush against the door sill. You squeeze through the opening between the cupboard and the wall. Landing. You are on a landing of a steep stairwell headed up and down. A large cupboard against the aft wall blocks the doorway to the captain's quarters. We got past it. Okay. Well, let's go down. Aft hold. This is a gloomy, damp area at the bottom of the Helena Lewis.
To the fore, there seems to be a little more light. You can climb up some stairs. Well, let's go north. You hear a scuffling noise ahead and a scraping up near the ceiling. You would think that it is caused by rats, but for the definite curse you heard before the movement. Hold. Steep stairs lead up in the dimness to a canvas hatch above. Rats scratchings counterpoint the lullaby of bilge water sloshing in the bulkheads, punctuated by footsteps slapping the deck overhead. You may move fore or aft. Behind a high fence, decorated by a sign, are stacked the food and ammunition supplies, casks of rum, water, flour, and salt meat, interspersed with kegs of gunpowder and shot. A closed gate is the only way in. You gradually notice a familiar worrying smell. Sniff and identify it as smoke. A tiny glowing fire creeps across a stretch of floor inside the cage of ammunition. Ooh, dangerous. All right, so what are we gonna do? Let's go north. Crew's quarters. The crew sleeps in shifts in this cramped space under the forecastle. A breeze blows in on a moonbeam through a grate in the ceiling. A low door sill is abaft. The area must also serve as a sick room. Strewn about the floor are various powders and spills of malodorous potions. In one corner, a large blood stain indicates an amputation. In another, the smear of a leech dropped off a bloodletting. A small bottle has dropped nearby. A chipped piece of mirror sits propped on a shoulder-high timber. All right, so let's go ahead and take bottle. Taken.
I gotta let Lafon know he's coming.
Crewley stands on the deck above, talking to himself, his voice floating down through a grate in the ceiling.
First, I do the mates aboard ship with this and the other mischief.
He grunts. And you hear a slapping noise, like a taut rope being cut.
Now to warn the boss and collect me pay. Off I go, har!
He dives into the sea. Interesting. Let's take the mirror. Taken. Alright, let's examine the bottle. It's a small leather bottle with a tiny label on one side. It appears to be almost empty. Let's read label. The label reads, laudanum drops. Squeeze onto a glass of wine. Oh, into a glass of wine to sleep free of pain and mental anguish. Ah, very good. We'll probably need those later. Let's go south. Ooh, the fire's still creeping across a stretch of floor. Let's examine the cage. The fence is made of thick, finely woven wire mesh. Uncuttable, unclimbable, except for a gap about 6 inches over the closed gate. The cage is secured from the ceiling to the damp floorboards. Well, I don't think that we are supposed to put out this fire. And because I can't save, I'm going to get out of here. South. Up. And let's open door. Opened. It's a dark, messy bed set entirely within the filling of a large cupboard. A cabin boy must sleep here when Jameson isn't using it. Kicked into the far corner is a pile of clothes. Interesting. Let's enter. Sleeping cupboard. The bed is softer than it looks, plumped up with fresh straw. A soft, if somewhat cramped, bunk for the tall bunk of Jameson. The cupboard opens to the fore. Kicking to the corner is a pile of clothes. Let's get clothes. You pick up the pile of clothes. Separate into a pair of breeches and a shirt. There we go. We have breeches and a shirt. Let's remove dress. You take off the cotton frock. Examine self. You're wearing absolutely nothing besides a linen chemise. Your kid slippers and a few layers of unmentionables. Mama would have been shocked. All right, let's go ahead and wear the breeches and wear the shirt. there we go. We're going to look a little bit mannish now since it's masking our figure. And, let's get out. And south. She gets back in. Let's get coffer. Taken, the end of a rope ladder blows past the window. Your eyes are drawn to a flicker of light off the sea. Squinting, you see a man swimming to shore, moonlight flashing off his hook. All right, so we got to get ourselves out of here. So let's throw coffer through window. You hurl the coffer through the window, sending it and a shower of glass into the sea. The ledge now looks deep enough to sit upon. The end of a rope ladder blows past the window. Can we get... we have to sit on ledge. It does say it's deep enough to sit upon. All right. The ladder just within reach. Perfect. Okay, so... put all in... I'm missing a letter here. All right, so we didn't put our shirt or breeches into our little sack coming off our wrist, but we put pretty much everything else that we weren't wearing in. Apparently you can remove your linen chemise if you want. We don't want to. All right, let's take ladder. You reach out for the ladder and overbalance, tumbling from your perch. Your hand closes on a slimy hemp rung as you fly over the waves, clinging tenuously, feet free to the ladder. On the ladder, you are clinging to a slimy ladder tied to a rail of the poop deck above you. Not far from your feet, waves kiss the stern of the ship. All right, well, we better go up. All the air driven out of you as the ladder slams into the stern. The reefs are definitely getting larger. Up. You climb the ladder, passing the halfway point. Rebounding, the ladder twists you around to face the Hella Lewis. Climb the ladder. The ladder swings towards the Hella Lewis. Up. You heave yourself over the stern rail and sink breathlessly to the deck of the Helena Lewis. Poop! From this platform deck, you can see the whole of the two-masted shadowy forms moving about here and there. The railing protects you from stepping off the deck in any direction but to the fore. A rope ladder is tied to the railing of the stern of the ship. The reefs are definitely getting larger. Okay, so we definitely got to get out of here. And let's see what we should do. Let's go north. Quarterdeck, no torches are lit or needed on this moonlit night, except in the deep shadows cast by the huge navigation wheel. Men move about the fore, talking quietly. Under the stairs aft to the poop is a barred door. Reefs are definitely getting larger. The abaft the wheel sits a large pyramid of casks held in place by heavy rope. Cantiline the deck aimed at open sea and the island. All right, what do we do here? Let's go north again. Main deck. It's a deceptively quiet evening on the ship. The pirates singing low shanties as they repair cannon, twist ropes, and sharpen daggers. The main mast casts an inky shadow over the canvas screening the hatch. A tangled mass of rigging hangs down from the mast, like many rope ladders woven together. The reefs are definitely getting larger. Two large barrels stand near the stair to the foredeck. We're now in the forecastle. Higher than all but the poop deck, this end of the ship commands a good view of the island. The crow's nest swinging above in the heights of the foremast would command a better... A tangled mess of rigging hangs down from the mast like many rope ladders. Embedded in the deck is a grated air hole to the crew's quarters below. You can go aft or forward through a break in the ubiquitous railing. Odors of grease and char waft from a little shack perched behind the mast. The reefs are definitely getting larger. You can see a mooring winch here. So, I believe that's what we need. Let's examine the winch. Whoops. Made of an old barrel turning on a pole, the mooring winch is used to coil the anchor chain. A pair of metal teeth bite the link to prevent it from dragging out. A lever is connected to the teeth. Something is written on the lever. On the lever is written, open up, close down. You notice the lever is pointed down. This is closed. Okay. So we need to pull lever up. The metal teeth open as you raise the lever. The anchor, released, splashes down to the sea, dragging its clanking chain. After a moment, you feel the ship pull slightly against the current. You lower the lever to prevent any more chain from spooling out. So there we go. We have saved the ship from hitting the... what the heck are they called? The coral? Was it coral that was getting closer? Maybe it was reefs. Probably coral reefs. The reefs were definitely getting closer, and now they no longer are. So we're good to go on that front. Let me head back south and examine the barrels. The two open barrels contain rum and water. You can tell by the smell of each. They are identical, but for the dark stains around the mouth of the rum barrel. With a heave of and creaking of timbers, the Helena Lewis drifts a little way back towards the island. The tide has turned. Interesting. Maybe that means we'll be able to swim better if we need to. We need some rags here is what we need. So we're going to tear our dress. You rip a large rag out of the cotton frock. And we're going to use it in the water. Put rag in water. Aha, I know what we're going to do here. You probably could stick it in the rum, but this wouldn't help. Keeping hold of the rag, you soak it with water. Okay, let's open hatch. Whoops. You pull the corner of the canvas out of the frame. Steep stairs descend into the murky darkness. Down. You glance around to see no one is watching and duck through the open corner of the canvas hatch. Tiny glow of fire creeps across a stretch of floor inside the cage full of ammunition. All right, we saved it from crashing into the reef, but now we still need to put out this fire. Luckily, we have this water here. Let's throw rag over gate. You throw the rag over the gate. Luckily, it lands directly on the burning end of the fuse. With a sputter and a sigh, the flame dies. Very good. We need to go back up. We need to go back south. And we need to examine the casks. Lying on their side, the casks are stacked in a rather large, shaky pyramid. Perhaps that's why someone has tied a rope around them. A cask on one corner has lost its lid.
Hey, boy, get away from those. It ain't safe, yells a sailor.
Ah, they think we're one of the... we think we're the cabin boys since we're dressed like him. Which is a good thing, I suppose. Pardon me. All right, in the galley. This tiny kitchen smells of old stew and yeast. A low door to the starboard shows the way out. A dagger is driven to the wooden floorboards. An entirely bald man sits here, carving into his peg leg. The man looks you over sharply, then winks an eye.
Hello, boy. Sam, I'll call you. Nervous about Captain? He'll come to no harm. And if there is trouble, he only has to signal from that seaward winder in the house. You can see it from the crow's nest, and we'll be there in a jiffy. Me and my peg are to stay aboard and guard you, the captain's young lady.
It sounds like he was going to say you, but he's playing dumb to the situation, which is nice of him. So, let's, now that we're in here, go ahead and... I think we need to take this dagger. All right, so we need to go back south. I mean, we could write fore and aft, but we're going to go south. South. And we're going to look in cask. See a slab of pork. All right, let's take the pork. The slab of pork is beyond reach at the bottom of the cask. Let's enter cask. You crawl into the cask, feeling a slab of something stuck to the bottom. From this close, you can see the line is getting frayed where it rubs against the cask. Okay, get pork. You peel off the cask. I don't know, there might be some more porking than this in this game, if it's as romantic as it's supposed to be. Let's put all in... and of course, if we're putting everything away, it means something is about to happen. Oh, I forgot to put except dagger. Take out dagger. Taken, okay. So we have our dagger out. I could have said put all except dagger and that would have worked. Cut rope.
With the dagger.
Oh, it puts it in brackets for us.
The line snaps and the pyramid collapses into a dozen of tumbling casks. Your cask is thrust into the sea, the dagger flying from your hands.
Oh, we've lost the dagger.
Sputtering mouthfuls of salt water, you look around several minutes later. Lagoon in the cask. You are crouched in a cask on the lagoon of Saint Sinistra. The jungle looms green, gray-green in the light of the full moon. All right, so we've made our way to the island. Examine pork. With a slab of pork caked with white with salt. It's rock hard. The current pulls you towards the island. Time passes. The current pulls you towards the island. Lagoon in the cask. You are crouched in the cask. All right. Aha! Shallows in the cask. You are crouched in the cask. In the warm, lapping waves of the shallows, a white sand beach is west of you. A skiff nods in the waves, its oars jerking around the current. Aha! So we've made it to the same place that he put down. So, let's leave cask. Free of your weight, the cask bobs and spins in the current, pulled out into the lagoon. You splash after it, but it is gone. Oh well. So we can't use that. Let's examine the skiff. The skiff is large enough to carry several men, but light enough that you feel you are able to row it. Oh, very good. And let's look where are the exits here. West. This is a tiny beach at the base of vine-covered cliffs. To the east, the Helen Lewis floats serenely on the lagoon. Immediately north of you, a rocky staircase is hewn into cliff. I suppose we should go north then. Lawn. The jungle looms around this clipped lawn, a path meandering westwards toward into the dense undergrowth. To the east is a folly entangled in blooming jasmine. The way to the beach is obscure but visible to the southeast. Behind the folly is a thorny hedge. A thorny hedge blocks the cliff view of the sea. Music and voices float from the veranda to the north. Two men are whispering in the shadows. You catch an occasional word. Davis dead. Girl. Falcon on Sinistra. The men separate, the well-dressed one going into the ballroom. As the other slinks into the bushes, you see his face. Cruelly. All right, we don't like that guy. However, we're going to head to the east. Folly, perfumed by the heady odor of the night-blooming jasmine entwined in the bamboo latticework, this folly is cool, is a cool, dark haven. One bamboo slat in the back seems to be loose. A bench is built into the wall, circling the folly. Okay, so clearly we're supposed to remove this slat. They're really walking us through it this so far. I suppose there were a couple puzzles that were solved on the boat. It's bedlam for you. Captain Jameson enters the folly, swooping to avoid the flowers dangling over the door.
I thought I heard someone. What the devil are you doing here? Lafond is a dangerous man to play with.
What an astonishing girl you are, my dear, and so ingeniously dressed. He plucks a flower from the tangle above the door and sets it in your hair.
The beauty of this blossom is nothing to yours.
Oh, he's such a talker. All right, let's wait and see what he has to say.
Catching his breath, Jameson pulls you against him, his hands circling your waist, crushing the flower between you.
Darling, he whispers, leaning over. Oh, my angel.
My lovely, Jamin says huskily. His eyes burn intently. They're blue like the sea on a summer day. A shiver of warmth flows through you, and you tremble at his touch. The pirate's hands, warm and exciting, caress you, searing through the linen of your chemise. His lips near yours, his breath softly scented. May I kiss you? Now, you could say no, but we're not going to.
Yes.
Breathless, eager, you lean into him, tender in his kiss, soft his lips as his body presses hard against you. You drown in the tide of your passion, swept like the sea against the rocks of the shore. Interesting. Zed. With a pent-up sigh, Nicholas forces himself away from you. Now is not the time or the place to advance my suit, he says wistfully. But the night is still young, and you are so beautiful. I must be gone, lest I lose my soul in you. With an engaging smile, he bows and leaves the folly.
What, he's not going to help us do anything? We're not going to warn him that everybody knows he's here? Well, east. Can't go that way. North? Can't go that way. South? West? Lawn. Oh, you know what happened? He interrupted me. Let's go back east. Yeah. Remove slat. Don't be absurd. What? What am I supposed to do? Take slat? Only the bottom of the slat is loosed. The rest is tightly woven into the frame of the folly. Okay, so... how am I supposed to get this thing out? Move slat? See, I can't remove it. I can only move it. You twist aside the loose slat, wedging the end into the woven wall. The remaining hole just above the bench looks just big enough to snake yourself through. Snake through. Ah, he just used that word. All right, I think now we can finally go east instead. In the hedge, you crouch in the green rustling of the hedge. Not far east, the wind keens up the cliff. High above the swell, breaking against the rocky shore, you know the folly is somewhere to the west. North, the hedge is somewhat less dense. Well, I guess we're going that way. By the house, you crouch at the hedge of the house, twigs poking into you. The cliff crumbles away to the east. The hedge seems less dense to the south. A closed window is directly west of you. Open window. Opened. All right, so can we go west now? Yes, we can. Everything in this private office is larger than life. A huge portrait decorates the north side, black drapes mask the east wall. Bookshelves tower over the cherry desk, and a massive wood globe squats in the corner. Music wafts distantly from the ballroom across the hall to the south. An expensive hat is hanging on a knob. Okay, so let's examine the portrait. The portrait seems familiar. You realize it is exactly the picture on the front of the banknote Lafon sent you. The same clothes, same surroundings, same pose. More like same poser. Ha ha! Let's examine the bookshelves. Most of the books appear unread, their pages uncut. The spine's not yet creased, all except one. Triste of Power by Sir Michael Villiards. Villiards? I suppose we're probably supposed to take that or do something with it later. Examine book. Take Triste of Power. You have to tip the book out of the shelf when it snaps surprisingly back into place. There's a mysterious scraping sound from inside the wall. I don't know that we were supposed to do that yet. So, let's examine the globe. Massive globe painted in blues. Greens, blues, and white describes the world as presently known. A lot of this stuff is not required, but we're doing it for points. Take hat. As you lift the hat from its knob on the wall, a low vibration tingles your legs from the floor. Interesting. South? For safety's sake, you leave the hat on its knob. Best not to show you've been wandering.
East hallway. The carpeted hallway turns from the west to the north here, extending the east wing. A long table blocks the way south. A black, garbled butler marches up to you. It was made clear at the whippings that villagers are not admitted in this house. He grasps you by the scruff of the neck and propels you head first out the front door. Main entrance! The front door stands open to the south. Light splayed out onto the drive, stretching north to the jungle. A path leads around the western wing of the house. Jutting out from the east wing is a tall hedge. There's not more. You said there was more. Alright, so we've been kicked out of the house. Oh well. Let's head west. The gravel path is just wide enough for a cart to pass. It bends around the west wing of the house, leading you to the trade entrance. You are on the well-trampled lawn at the side of the house. One low door leading to the east. Graveled paths lead north and south in the undergrowth. Okay, so let's go ahead to the... I'm going to go north or south. Let's go east. Why are we going back to the east? Kitchen. Okay. Doesn't make sense to me, but that's where we are. A fire pit in the floor smokes badly. Fogging up the depths of this large kitchen, somehow not escaping through either the south or west doors. A blonde woman huddles alone by the fire, as if cold. The woman smiles uncertainly and then rushes over. Are you come from the village, boy? Dost know Lord Dimsford? She sighs at your surprise. So he sent you. I'm his Lucy. It's been so long since I've seen him. Lafond caught me eavesdropping. Now I can't leave the grounds. Uh-oh. That's not good. Let's examine Lucy and see how she's doing. Lucy is a very pretty woman. A few years your senior. Her yellow hair neatly arranged. A few years your senior. Apparently she's something to do with your dad. She wears a cook's apron. I haven't found Lafond's papers. I'm watched too closely. Tell Dimsford that I'm scared. I want him to come and get me. Give this to him. He'll recognize it. Lucy slides a garter down her leg and holds it out to you. We didn't necessarily want to know that. Take the garter, though. Lucy kisses your head and returns to the fire humming. Okay, let's go west, south, north. Oh, the forest. Buried in the subtropical growth, you lose all sense of being on someone's private estate. The jungle seems to extend for miles on all sides of you. Footworn path cards from the east to the north here. The vegetation lessens to the northeast. Let's go to the northeast. Clearing, you're a small clearing. Under the western side of the house, heavy vines creep up the wall past the second floor window. Open to the night air. Southwest is an opening in the bush. Alright, what do we got to do here then? Let's climb the vine. You take a firm grasp on a particularly thick tendril. Jerk once to secure it. And scamper up the wall like some huge tropical spider. It's easy to climb through the window. Bedroom lit only with moonlight through the open window. Tonight this room is serving as a lady's dressing room. An exit lies to the north. Draped across the bed is a lovely cream-colored water silk gown. It looks about your size. Alright, so, you know what we're going to have to do. Remove clothes. I gotta try it. Remove... Oh, but that wouldn't be decent. I knew they'd have something there. Let's probably take the dress. Take gown. Wear a gown. The beautiful ball gown fits perfectly, the creamy silk bringing a glow to your cheeks. You comb your hair with your fingers and bite your lips to make them red. I didn't know that worked. All right, so now we need to take... invitation and put girder in reticule. Done. Okay, we don't want that to get caught. Let's go north. Upstairs halls. You stand in a carpeted hallway leading east to the stair landing. Rooms lie north and south of you. Parlor. In this room, the exotically furnished with a turkey divan and chairs. The exit is to the south. A pair of dueling pistols is mounted high on one wall.
Take those pistols. You can't reach them. Ladies don't carry pistols anyways. Boo! Ladies can carry pistols. South. East. Stair landing. East-west hallway opens here to curve to the grand staircase sweeping into the foyer. East. Upstairs hall. You stand in a carpeted hallway leading west to the stairs landing. To the north is an ornately carved door. From the south comes the impression of air and... or light and air. Alright. Let's open that door up and see what happens. Oh, it's locked. South. You are on a wide balcony overlooking the ballroom. A hallway lies to the north. Down on the dance floor, you see a myriad... You see myriad colors as the guests weave the intricate steps of their dances. A chandelier is held above the dance floor by a rope and pulley system, so that servants can lower it to light and snuff its candles. Several feet of rope hang down from the pulley, the excess tied around the railings. Alright, so what are we going to do here now? I think we just need to go to the north. That hallway, upstairs hall. West, we are now at the stairs. Let's go down. We now know all the important stuff we need to know. In the foyer, Granius... staircase splits and twists up to the next floor here, framing the entrance south to the ballroom. Long hallways lead east and west. Cool night air drifts in through the front door north of you. The butler stands near the entrance to the ballroom, not recognizing you at all. Alright, so we probably have to give him the invitation. The butler takes the invitation. Enjoy the dance, Miss Davis. Oh, very good. Let's go south into the dance floor. A sea of spectators parts to admit you, murmuring approval. Ah, very good. I suppose if you had your clothes on, you'd just get kicked out again. Ballroom, Lafon's party is well attended. You can hardly move for the crush. However, the room is oddly silent. No talk, interrupting the musical efforts of the musicians to the west. Despite the heat, no one ventures south to the veranda, nor through the opening east. The foyer is north of you. Captain Jameson moves up to you, saying, "May I have this dance?" He doesn't wait for an answer, sweeping you onto the dance floor. Ah, huh, we're dancing now. Alright. We don't want to embarrass ourselves, so we shall also dance. You pace out the steps. "I haven't found your father. We've long suspected a passage under the library, but I cannot find an entrance." "We already opened it up," says Jameson. The steps of the dance separate you a moment. As you twirl around and curtsy to another dancer, you glide back into the captain's arms and dance again. You pace out the steps. "If there is any trouble, I am unable to help, a signal from the upstairs seaward window will bring my men. They can be here in moments," the captain says. Your hands linked tightly with his, held high over your heads. A line of dancers flies between you and Jameson. Dance! You step out the paces. "I wish you would call me Nicholas. I feel I know you much better than our brief acquaintance would allow." He presses your hand. Together you twirl around the ballroom, his arms snug around your waist, leading you gracefully, masterfully. Nicholas's grip tenses. Ah, I guess in our mind he somehow knew we weren't calling him Nicholas in our mind. Nicholas's grip tenses as he nods to a bewigged man staring at you. Your turn, and the man moves on. You turn and the man moves on. Have we danced enough yet? I don't know. Jameson touches your hair softly. The music ends with a flourish, and you pirouette once more before curtsying to Jameson. As you move to the side of the dance floor, Nick adds, We should separate. "I'm sure I'm being watched. You would be safer aboard the Helen Louise. If you slip out the veranda doors, no one will notice you leaving." He touches your hand and dissolves into the crowd, like a puff of smoke, apparently. All right, we've done all our dancing.
Please be.
It's getting a little late in the day. This game is taking longer than I thought. Well, I guess it's not that much longer than I thought it was going to take. Let's, now that we've danced enough, head to the west. Orchestra. A few older women, young girls, sit near a small orchestra assembled at this end of the ballroom. Let's examine the orchestra. A small band is made up of a virginal bass and treble
violas and violas and several recorders. Those are like, everyone knows how to play the recorder. They are playing "I Want to Kiss Your Hand" by J.S. Beadle. That is great. That was probably worth some points. But was it truly worth some points? Let's go ahead and probably head back to the east, I would imagine. Oh, a fashionably bewigged man stalks up to you and bows deeply. "Will you dance?" he asks in a "Will you dance?" he asks in a light French accent. "Not that you have much choice. If you turn me down, your father dies." Oh, you know who it is. "One cannot dance the minuet alone." "I am, of course, La Fonde," he laughs triumphantly. And pulls you into the dance. All right, let's do we dance again? Is that how we take care of business here? No, let's examine La Fonde. Wigged in a dark brown curls, dressed in velvets and brocade, he is warmly attractive until you meet his eyes, stone gray and cold. "So you know I am not your father's friend," Lafon says, offering a hand for the promenade. "Unfortunately, you are in my power. He is in my dungeon, and I am still king of these waters." A gold ring flashes on his hand. It seems vaguely familiar. Let's examine the ring. It's an ancient gold band with a curious design of gargoyles, curled tongues extended on its flat face with "Sal Sapit Omnia" engraved on the bottom. It would appear that he has the same ring. He must have stolen this from Nick's brother. "La Fonde, eyes rake your body. When I am ready, the butler will summon you to sup with me in my room. It may be some time. We will find much in common before dawn, I am sure. Then I may free your father." Lafon bows as the dance ends and kisses your hand. He cocks his head, curious. "You have far less spirit than your father credited you. He swore you would have freed him in no time at all. A pity. I prefer Dionettes with metal." He moves to speak with the butler, then drifts into the crowd. Okay, we're free of him for now. Now, we know how to get to the dungeon, because clearly it was from going that way, or doing that thing before, but let's open door. Opened. All right, let's go south. Veranda. Steps lead south from this white marble veranda to a clipped lawn. To the north is a line of people blocks your view of the ballroom. All right, so north. See a spectator's parts of Mitchum, murmuring approval. North. Foyer. The butler stands at the entrance of the ballroom. Okay. East. No, ma'am. That way is private. The butler stops you. That doesn't work well. South. East. This is a supper room. One long table set across the north entrance indicates that supper was served here earlier. West of you is the ballroom. You scuttle underneath the long table. East hallway. Haha, we're sneaky as heck. Okay, north. Offensive hat is hanging on the knob. Okay, so we need to take the book again. You half tip the book out of place and shelf. Snap surprisingly back into place. Let's take the hat. I think the door is already open. Press Sinistra on globe. You press the painted island and it sinks into the wooden sea. You hear a whirl, a click, as the portrait pops open. A draft of sea-scented air flows from behind it. Aha! For safety's sake, you leave the hat on the knob. Best not to show you've been wandering. You move the portrait. You move beyond the portrait into the flickering torchlight. Stairwell. Cool salt air blows past a torch on a spiral staircase below you, ruffles your hair, and circles south into the library. So we need to go down. Bottom stairwell. Flickering torchlight at the bottom of the stair of the spiral staircase. A draft blows from the east. A passage leads south. North Passage. A strong wet breeze blows from a low doorway to the east. A circle of light leads west. The passage continues south. All right, well, I guess I'm probably going east. Guard's bunk room. Once a cell, now with a door missing. Made into a guard's bunk room, this room is distinctly uncomfortable. Gasps of air are forced through a crack in the seaward wall of the room. The way out is west of you. A powder horn hangs from a long strap on the wall. A canvas cot is shoved against a wall. Sitting on the cot is a large key. Alright, I'm probably going to need this stuff. Let's take key, take horn. Alright. Let's go back to the west and south. Open door. So we were at the far end of a dank passage heading north. A wooden door leads east. Open door, opened. Now we can go probably to the east. Cell, this tiny cell is airless, shivering cold, entirely empty of anything but darkness. A wooden door leads west. So, I guess we go back west, north, west. We're at the bottom of the stairwell. South. Anteroom. Two exits lead from this cavernous room, north and south. The wall drips wet, forming a huge pool on the floor. A crocodile lives half in the pool, gazing at you with baleful eyes. Jaws wide open, dagger-sharp teeth glint in the torchlight. How are we going to deal with this crocodile? Time passes. Oh, wait, I know what we need to do. Squeeze. I just wasted some time. I hope I don't fail this game. Bottle on pork. You squeeze three colorless drops onto the slab of pork. A patch of salt dissolves as the laudanum absorbs into the meat. I think we just need to throw the pork. Thrown. Get pork. Taken. That's not how we have to do it. We have to give pork to crocodile. Crocodile snaps its jaws shut as the slab of pork disappears into its maw. With an inaudible creak, crocodile's mouth opens again. Without warning, the crocodile relaxes, eyes closed, asleep. Very good. South. Dungeon, you sense rather than see the rusty skeletons of old cages and torch devices that line the walls of this cavernous room. One flaming torch high on a wall casts mad licks of light into the darkness. Passages lead north and west. Set deep into the rocky floor is a closed trap door. A pair of manacles hangs from iron chains attached high on the wall. All right, we need to go. I believe it's west. Because we came from the north, right? Corner, a short passage turns east to north to stop abruptly at an iron door. Unlock door. With large key. Unlocked. Very good. Open door. Let's head north. Cell. Hewn from dense rock, the cell is a stagnant burrow. Except for the tiniest glow of light from the torch two rooms away, it's pitch black. As you enter, a tall, bony man moves out of the darkness. Papa, you cry, rushing to his arms. Why, hello, my dear. He hugs you tightly. Nick certainly took his time about fetching you. Ha ha, so he did. Well, we have to give him the leg thing, garter. To your father. He smiles dreamily at the memory. Ooh. You briefly explain the current situation to your father. I knew Falcon would do his best to rescue me once you were safe, he responded. Now to rescue Lucy. Nicholas will have told you about her. You get him while I get Lucy, and the four of us will meet down at the beach. Just show me the way out of this maze and we'll get started. Very good, Father. Alright, so. I thought he might say more if he waited. South. Potter mutters something to himself. Your occasional zounds. East. Papa follows you. North. We're in the anteroom. The crocodile is half and pool sleeping. Papa enters just a few steps behind you. Your father stops, smiling at the crocodile. Hello, chum. How are you? He bends over the creature and scratches its belly, muttering.
Never seen you sleep like this before. It stirs to life as your father walks over to you by the north entrance. The reptile waking lunges after him, choking on its chain. Haha, Dad had a little bit of fun with that. Alright. At the bottom of the stand rail. And we need to go up. South. Move beyond the portrait into the library. The library at expensive half hangs on the knob. Papa enters just a few steps behind you. A window, your father exclaims. I shall creep out to the kitchen. Get the falcon. He climbs out the window. East hallway. There's a commotion from the west. A woman screams and a man yells, "Stop, pirate!" You run to the foyer in time to see two dragoons dragging the battered frame of Captain Jameson's. An officer quiets the guests. This is the buccaneer who's been pirating our ships. He has the audacity to come here tonight intending to assassinate our dear governor. Do not worry, ladies. He was arrogant enough to come alone. The officer marches after his men. The dancers return to their banal conversations. Foyer, the butler stands at the near the entrance of the room. Okay, so this is not good. North. North. We're at the front drive, a rutted drive north-south here. From a high spiked gate through the jungle of to La Fontaine's mansion, you hide in the bushes nearby. Dragoons converse quietly. Patrol the other side of the gates. Okay. South. Main entrance. Butler walks up to you. Monsieur Lafond requests your presence in his room immediately. Miss, he points to the stairs, bows, and leaves. South. Foyer. All right. South. See his spectators. Separate, murmuring their approval. North. North. South. Up. I think we're just making the right amount of time pass there. East. Knock on door. Lafond calls. Gum. He would want us to do that, wouldn't he? Alright, let's open door. North. Lafond's bedroom. Lafond is leering, lips curled. A lace-covered table crouches beside a wing-backed chair in one corner. Sitting on the table is a green goblet, a blue goblet, and a flagon. Have some wine. Lafond pours wine into two glasses, giving the blue one to you. Drink this down. We have a long night ahead of us. He drains his own. And we are actually supposed to drink the wine. I believe. You empty the blue goblet of wine. Good girl, he says. Let's see more cooperation of this sort. Suddenly, the door slams open. It's Jameson, coatless, sword bared, his shirt ripped. Thank God I'm not too late. Leave, darling, before I skewer this dog to his bedpost, he cries. The scar on his cheek gleams coldly. With a yell, cruelly, and the butler jump out of the darkness behind him. Nicholas struggles, but soon lies unconscious on the floor. Take him to the dungeon, Lafond says, settling down his glass. You butler, stay nearby. I do not wish to be disturbed again. Now that we are rid of that intrusion, Cherie, I will change into something more comfortable. Pour me more wine. He crosses to the wardrobe, removing his coat and vest. Turns slightly away from you. All right. So we need to pour wine into green goblet. You fill the wine in. Fill the green goblet with wine. In private, you may call me Jean or whatever endearment you choose. Once I have approved it, Lafond is looking into the wardrobe. We need to do some more of this squeezing here. Squeeze bottle into green. Into green goblet. You squeeze three colorless drops into the green goblet. You sense Lafond hesitate, then continue primping. The butler enters, laying a silver tray of cold chicken on the table. The kitchen wench has gone, Your Grace. I took the liberty of fetching these myself. He bows and leaves the room. Sprinkle some spice on the fowl, ma petite, Lafond says, donning a large brocade robe. Is back to you. They are hot but delicious. All right, so we need to pour wine into blue goblet. You fill the blue goblet with wine. Tsk, the cook has gone too far. She'll be leaving us tomorrow. Lafond adjusts the lace at his neck. All right. Lafond strolls to the table, smiling sadly. Which glass was mine? I seem to have forgotten. He points at the green goblet and smiles in a way that does not grant you confidence. Is this it? Oh, Lafond, he's already drunk. No. Wait. Points at the green one. Yes. Whew. The FAQ seems to imply that he's going to point at the blue one and you have to say no. But in this case, he asks if the green goblet was his. So, yes, of course. Lafond obligingly takes the green goblet. He inhales deeply the bouquet of his wine and then turns to you. Oh, snap. Oh, I fucked the game up. He inhales deeply the bouquet of his wine and then turns to you. You must think me very naive to fall for such a trick. I saw you pour something into one of these glasses, although I cannot smell it. He switches the goblet, setting the green goblet into your nerveless grasp, taking the otherwise smile evidently. You will now drink from the cup intended for me. Shoot! There's probably no way out of this. Drink. Blue goblet. You can't drink the blue goblet. Drink, we must not waste all night. He pushes a glass towards your mouth. Oh, this is not going to go well. Drink wine. You empty the green goblet of wine. Good girl, he says, and takes a leather bottle and drops it out the window. You shall not need this. You may suffer no headaches in my employ. He lifts the glass to drink, but stops. Your father, for all his idiotic meddling in other people's business, is not a fool. I doubt you are either. He calls the butler, ordering him to empty the blue goblet. The man reports no odd taste and returns to his post. Oh, this is not good. This is not good at all. Alright, can we take spice? You take a pinch of spice between your thumb and forefinger. Your face convulses, and a prodigious yawn. Lafond draws near, whispering indecencies. He caresses your lily-white neck, his fingers ice cold despite the tropical heat. No! No, this is going to be the worst! Worst ending! What can we do? Throw spice at Lafond. You blow the spices off your fingertips directly into the Lafond's face. He sneezes, eyes watering from the heat of the peppers. Reaching blindly for some wine, he instead upsets the table, shattering a glass. Lafond stumbles, cursing out of the room in search of relief. All right, this probably still won't go well, but maybe we can still win with not maximum points. All right. Let's wave the mirror at window. You roll a bit of mirror around in the beam of moonlight till it glows silver white. After a moment, a flash of light responds from the Helenouise. You stare into space for a long, thoughtless moment. It seems very hard to think, but you aren't sure. You run out into the butler's barrel chest, leering grin. You return to the bedroom, the butler following. The governor said you are not to leave this room. Shoot, I don't know what we're supposed to do. Climb out window. You look at the sheer drop from below the sill to the hedge jagged rocks below. It is enough to dissuade you. Your eyes are extraordinarily dry. You blink to moisten them and snort away a minute later, drool dripping from your chin. Dang it. Sleep overtakes you, slump unconscious. You awake at sunrise. The governor of St. Sinistra provides you with food and shelter, at least until he grows tired of your body and presence. You have suffered a face worse than death. In 248 turns, you have achieved a score of 18 out of 25. This gives you the rank of Darling Damoiselle. You may start over, restore a save position, which I couldn't do, or end this session of the game. Oh, we were so close. There was literally like I don't know, a paragraph left in the FAQ to do. So, this sucks. We would have had to go save our friend. But, what a terrible ending. Maybe we'll visit this game again next year. But for now, I'm Zerfall. We've been playing Plundered Hearts and failing at it miserably. Thanks for watching!